Good morning. Thank you for inviting me to speak today at LATAM's conference, and I'm super excited to share my thoughts on crisis innovation. Big shout out to the team, Miriam and Gabrielle and Perla and everybody for inviting me to be part of their amazing conference, and shout out to all the other keynote speakers that are making the time to share our experience and our wisdom in the areas of startup and entrepreneurship. Some of you know me, some of you don't, so I'm going to take a few minutes of your time to introduce myself as we talk about crisis innovation, especially during these crazy times that is unprecedented and also an amazing opportunities for people that thrive in chaos, people that look for opportunities in the world. And that's why I'm so excited to meet all of you today virtually. And I'll also leave my contact details at the very end to connect and engage and follow and support as many of you possible on your entrepreneurial journey. So the topic of my presentation is crisis innovation and how to innovate during a crisis economy. I've been blessed to be part of a few disruptive economies and come out of it, you know, on the top. And I'll walk you through sort of how, you know, that has helped me really adapt and understand what's happening with COVID and how some of the startups that we had started ended up surviving and becoming very profitable with the shift in mindset and in our approach. A bit about me, I started my first business, Spider Designs, in 1999. While I was still in university, I had no idea the kind of life I was going to live, but I knew it was going to be one on my own terms, one where I get to dictate how I want to spend my time and how I wanted to earn and how I wanted to build relationships. And back then, it wasn't called entrepreneurship. It was just unemployment. You either work for somebody or you were not working for somebody. So you can imagine being the eldest of a South Asian family who's led by academics. My dad's a super smart engineer. And so to be, you know, the first son of the clan and not wanting to follow those footsteps was really hard for my family. But I knew deep inside that I wanted to follow a different path and explore it and answer the burning question I had when I was very young. What makes me who I am? And who am I? And what are the things that I want to accomplish in life? And being an entrepreneur was the best way, and it still is the best way for me to continue to learn about myself, about my life and my brain and my emotions and how I make decisions and how I value things and people in my life. So my first company started in 1999, and those of you that are old enough to know, 1999 was the setup for 2000, and the whole world was going to end in Y2K. So that was really my first global pandemic crisis. Coming out of school, there wasn't any jobs. My friends, they were struggling to get employment because most people weren't applying or hiring anybody due to the world being shut down and technology sort of shutting down finance markets and economics issues. But for me, it was an interesting opportunity because there was a lot of technology needs that weren't being met. And that's where I started my second company, New Age Consulting, in 2000, where we were helping companies get through Y2K issues and Y2K ripple effects. We would hire programmers and get them to work with clients. And there was such a big demand that we were able to, without much experience, build a consulting company that was also a recruiting company. And I ran that for 2006 and exited to my partners and then continued my journey to build my third company, which is called Blue Band Brand and Digital. And Blue Band Brand and Digital was the perfect company for me. I wanted to learn how to tell stories. I wanted to learn marketing and PR. I wanted to learn what it was like to really take an idea and connect with an audience and have them emotionally opt into your brand values and then want to come and support you and buy your product and talk about you and become advocates in growing that company as CEO. By the time we exited in 2017, we had offices across Canada, India, Costa Rica. Over 65 people got up every single day to come to work with the belief that we can add immense amount of value to the companies that we were supporting through our marketing efforts and PR and digital and lead generation and and customer acquisition and content writing. And so I've had some of the best teachers in the world teach me how to survive, how to thrive, and also how to innovate. And I took that energy and helped co-found something called the Science Discovery Zone, which is a very unique incubator as part of Ryerson's innovative ecosystem around zone learning. And not only did I help co-found this thing, I became a champion for it. I got a chance to travel across the world and talk about education and entrepreneurship and supporting young people and building, you know, opportunities for marginalized communities, people of color, female entrepreneurs. And that led to the forming of Ballard Group. And Ballard Group started as a incubator, accelerator, blending the two with education and really supporting new immigrants, minorities, and female entrepreneurs in their pursuit of entrepreneurship. There's so many issues that was holding them back. And so we wanted to dive in and level the playing ground a little bit. And I spent most of 2018 and 2019 recruiting amazing founders into our program, helping them, you know, with their sales and marketing and self-growth, and also expanding into Brazil. And we had so much things going on. And then COVID happened. Let's get into that. So I found this quote that really sets the tone for what we're all experiencing in these innovative crises moments. You know, never let a serious crisis go to waste. And what I mean by that, it's an opportunity to do things you think you could not do before. And I remember when I come across this quote early April, I was like, man, what a bang on statement. It truly encapsulates what is it that we as entrepreneurs chase. You know, we look for opportunities in the market. We look for problems we want to solve. We look for markets that haven't been tapped into, or we look for innovative solutions to solutions that are already in market, you know. And that's why we get up in the morning to do what we do, regardless of what industry you're in, from tech to agriculture. You already know this, but sometimes we forget that, you know, this is why we are entrepreneurs. And it's not about building, you know, a store or going online and starting an e-commerce company or getting a few customers and being happy that you're in business. Well, what we really wanted to do, what we started, you know, any business for, is to figure out how we can help and find opportunities to do things differently and help people. And for me, COVID was a great reminder that that is why I do what I do. And that it's time to reset back to that thinking and really explore what are the things I'm doing and how do I do it a little bit better and differently. It's changed now. You know, the world that we knew will never be the same. And those of you that think, you know, it's going to come back one day or a few months from now, we'll be back to normal. I hate to tell you this, my friend, but the world has now permanently changed. Same way Y2K changed us, the same way the SARS pandemic changes us, and now COVID, and not only COVID, but there's a whole bunch of socioeconomic things that are impacting us as humans that we will never go back to the way things were. And so in this new reality where life is now going to be governed by a new set of human rules, how do you innovate? There's a few of us that innovated really quickly, you know. You took A and B, glued it together, and you're like, okay, I've solved it. But you know, short-term solution without a big vision for why you do things is not sustainable. And I want you to start over the course of the next 15, 20 minutes really thinking about all of the different things that you did. In early April, there was a Band-Aid reaction to COVID. And as you slowly strip away what works and what doesn't work, please, really only focus on things that are long-term, the things that add real, real value to you and your customer. So I was thinking about it as I was prepping this thing. How do I talk about crisis innovation? Because most of my, you know, speeches and keynotes is about business success stories, and I have lots of examples of great companies doing things. And in this case, because the world was shut down and I got to really focus on my own companies, I thought, well, why don't I give you guys a backstory around my own companies and what we did to innovate during these crisis moments. Applause is a music app. It connects musicians with their fans and allows them to make money using tips and booking engine, and more importantly, data that actually shows you who your customer is. We've been working on this thing since 2017 through a variety of innovation and pivot. And we're supposed to go to market this summer with over 50 music festivals across the country, ready to utilize our technology for their shows. Schoolio, I started last summer, and we wanted to build an Uber for education using teachers. Parents who wanted tutoring, new immigrants that were looking for support, had no way to access Ontario certified teachers. And that's what Schoolio was supposed to be, an Uber for teachers. And Daisy Fest, my music festival that we've been hosting for the last 13 years, is a large public outdoor event. Over 150,000 people show up every single year. And we knew we weren't going to be able to do that again. So all three of my businesses, my passion, my purpose, were completely disrupted as soon as the pandemic hit. And, you know, one of the things that we thought of when all these happened is, how do we innovate? And for me, the first three things we did was seeking the truth. You know, what that mean is, you know, with everything that forces you up against the wall, when your back is up against the wall, what you cannot hide from is a reality. You got to stop and you got to seek the truth. And in some cases, seeking the truth is really dissecting what is your problem solution that you're trying to solve. And has that changed? Is it still relevant in your business? Are we doing the right thing? In some cases, seek the truth means really understanding your numbers, right? So many CEOs I know of do not really understand their balance sheet or finances or the cost categories. And if you're not fully in tune with every dollar, where it goes and how it comes in, you're not going to be able to see the truth in what's happening in your business. So that was the second thing we meant by seek the truth. The third is your people. You know, the more you grow your company, sometimes the less connected you are to your own staff. And in moments of crises, the people you need around you the most are the people that are getting up every day to come to work for you. And so seeking truth for me was looking at those three things. Are we doing the right thing for the market? Do we really understand our economics? And do our people still get excited about wanting to take on the task of being with us? And the other thing that we really wanted to look at in these crisis innovation is, how is the product or service change with the customer, specifically the fit? Because everything we talk about in business is about market product fit, right? Or problem solution fit. And the fit has definitely changed. Every industry you know of, from retail to real estate to food and online, everything has dramatically changed. Some for the better. You know, if you're in the business of selling anything online, the business saw 100 or 200% increase, or even more, as people ran online to buy products and services that they need. And if your business wasn't online, you were hurting. You know, restaurants, bars, fitness centers, anywhere where humans wanted to go to, the fit was no longer there. So what is your new product and service fit? How can you service the market when the fit has changed? And the third, and this is an important one, in moments of crises, you got to throw the rule book out the door. You got to get rid of the logic temporarily. I know the people that are, you know, watching this with your MBAs and your PhDs are freaking out, going, what do you mean throw logic out? You know, what's my strategy? But there's something beautiful about throwing out logic for a minute and really embracing daydreaming about possibilities. And so much of that possibility chasing, daydreaming version of us, it gets muted, not destroyed or not cut out, gets muted with the day-to-day hustle of business. And now when everything is changing, letting out that inner daydreamer, the person who, you know, dreamt of this company, envisioned what it feels like to lead this company, that person needs to come back out. And the only way to do that is to move logic out of the way and let this person come out and really think about, what can I do to seek the truth and look at what is my product market fit? And those are the three things that we did ourselves in April as an organization to really understand where do we go from. And the last point I'll make before I get to the next slide, seek the truth doesn't mean seek the answer you want. It really means seek the truth. And sometimes with truth, the reality is not as nice. And we had to face a bunch of that. And it hurts and it breaks you down. But that's okay, because the truth can't hurt you. The lies do. So the sooner you realize what you're really dealing with, the faster you can become powerful from a position of confidence and make some moves. So to share our own backstory, one of the companies that we've been investing a lot of time and money called Skoolio for over a year now, to my left, as I said, it was for Uber for teachers. The concept is very simple. If you're a parent and you want to support your child with after-school programming, you can either drop them off in an education center and hope the teachers there are qualified, or you can partner with Skoolio, and now we've got digital online tutoring or in-person tutoring at your home or office, but everybody who's on Skoolio is a certified educator who studied the last 4 or 5 years to become a teacher, and they understand the curriculum and they know how to treat your young child with empathy and confidence and knowledge transfer. So no brainer in my head, because I've got two kids and one of them is constantly getting tutoring and we're spending all this money on her education without really understanding who is teaching her. I know who it is when I drop her off in school, it's teachers, but who are these people teaching her after school? And so we spent a year investing in technology, recruiting teachers, prototyping our live streaming system before COVID happened. And our plan was to launch in March 2020, during March break with a small MVP, and based on the results, launch again as a public beta during the summertime. And then if that went really well, get ready for the launch for September, which will be the new year, which is what we're in now. And that was the plan. We worked really, really, really hard. And what we realized when COVID happened is the parents do not care about tutoring right now. There was so many other problems in the world with work and lifestyle and finances that supporting the kids' after school program was not anybody's top of mind, including mine, you know? And so the entire market product fit failed in one swooping slice. And we were like, wow, what do we do now? We went looking for the truth. You know, parents just didn't have the empathy or the care to support their kids. They were freaking out. How do I homeschool now? What do I do for my kid? I don't know how to be an educator. I have a job. I can't just stop my job and teach my kid math, English, science, and social studies. What do I do? The market fit was gone. People were actually not looking for additional screen time for their kids, because all of the kids were already online playing games and Netflix and spending very little time offline. That was our way out as parents, let them go online a little bit more than normal. So we started to daydream. We started to daydream on all the different things that we can do for parents, because at our core, we still really care about empowering the parent to feel much more connected to be an educator at home. So we said, you know, why don't we just make us into a virtual school where parents could have access to curriculum for each grade by each subject, and until they figure out a better plan, we can give them the content they need to be able to teach at home. We'll follow the entire curriculum day by day. We will support them with teachers who can be on a hotline, on a standby to help them and take their phone call. And we'll create a very supportive network where parents could learn and heal and vent and share with other parents. Did it make any sense? Yes. Was it the best pivot idea? No. The revenue model was skewed. There was no recurring income anymore. We had to now do more in creating content and assets than we would have in the Uber for teachers. But this felt like a really good new problem to solve. And not only was our market size getting bigger because so many new parents were homeschooling, we already had an amazing base of homeschooling parents that we can tap into to learn. So that's what we did. We changed our model mid-March, getting into April, May, from an Uber for teachers to a homeschooling support network with resources for parents who are first-time homeschooling parents. And then we spent most of May and June and half of July really working on new content, recruiting new staff, negotiating rates cheaper so that we can employ a few more people to work for us. And we wanted to get our first batch of content out the door in August. And since August, we've been selling. People are buying, products are moving, and we're selling grade 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 for parents right now that are looking for homeschooling solutions. And it's incredible to see that credit card payment come through. It's incredible to see parents get our content and really thank us on social media for the work we've done. And now we've got a potential business that has a very good leg to grow over the next 6 to 8 months. And of course, there's going to be no more pivots. And of course, there's going to be more opportunities for innovation. But coming out of COVID, we didn't kill our dreams for Schoolio. We actually turned it into a profitable startup launch. The next three things I want to share, is about being fearless, costivation, and micro traction. Being fearless doesn't mean you rush into the fire, okay? Being fearless still means you're strategic about what you want to do. But you tell yourself that I'm not going to be afraid of taking risks because I'm more afraid of the regrets of not taking actions. So much of us, when we think about fear, we think about failure. You know, what if I make a wrong move? Or what if I make the right move, but it's at the wrong time? My business can fail. But for me, fearlessness is not about running out and taking blind risks. It's about reminding myself that the things that I want to accomplish, I will regret not taking a shot at doing it more than my fear of failure. And with that in mindset, we said, man, we got to now figure out how to move forward with some of these projects. You know, how can we make sure that we've touched every stone and turned it over? We've looked at every opportunity. We've talked to as many customers as possible and suppliers and employees to really get a sense of the landscape of where we can take our company to. Costivation is the definition of finding innovation in your costs, right? Really understanding where are you spending money, how are you spending money, and where can you allocate and reallocate funding. This is less about balance sheet, which looks for, you know, your ups and downs and your cash flow and your profitability. Costivation is about really looking for where can you identify innovation within your costs. And then micro traction, you know, we say this when we're building products in MVP, build those tractions. Demonstrate that the first customer will buy your solution. Demonstrate you can get to your first $100, then to your first 500, then to your first 1,000. Demonstrate you can show micro traction within your product market fit. And we had to get back to that. We said, how do we now show micro traction and moving fearlessly into new ideas and really focusing on how we can reallocate funding into new opportunities? For those of you that know me, I've been producing a festival called AC Fest for the last 13 years. We are in North America, the largest outdoor South Asian music festival, connecting over 100,000 people from age 16 to 65. And we get over 30 million impressions online. And you know, we have so many incredible, incredible statistics that demonstrate we are market leaders. The formula is very simple. We go and get a bunch of money from sponsors and partners and government folks, and we redistribute that money to artists and vendors and the whole music scene economy. Over the last 10, 12 years, we've raised over $2 to $3 million in funding that we've handed out. And we've had some great, great stories of cultural breakthrough, breaking down stereotypes and giving opportunities to people that never had any. It all stopped. Because humans can't get together anymore safely. So we sat there going, what do we do now? Our entire business model that is 13 years old is dead. And we have no control over it. We can't protect it. It's not like planning for a rainy day during a festival. It's not like planning for, you know, visa issues or equipment breakdown mid-show. This is a pandemic. Are we going to stop after 13 years of helping the community? No. Can we stop being the voice of a community? No. So we said, how do we do it? So April 4th, we decided we're going to go online. We're going to continue to engage the community. We're going to continue to engage artists. Then we're going to start live streaming. And if you can look back, very few people were doing live streaming in April. Most of us didn't know what the hell we were going to do in our lives, let alone think about technology. And we completely invested into live streaming. And April 4th was our very first concert. And for the next 3 months, we would do a concert every single night. And by the end of July, we had over 150 shows from across Canada, US, India, Pakistan, Africa. We had access to a ton of new artists that we typically wouldn't have been able to be exposed to because we're a live event. We saw over 1 million organic reach per month in those critical few months. We developed an incredible fan base that continued to support us. Our social media numbers went through the roof. We were able to reach new markets that we typically wouldn't have reached. And we saw an influx of new revenue from sponsors and government support that we typically wouldn't see because it's new. We're a global platform now. And the thing that we've been trying to do for the last 13 years is shift from a product-based company to a powerful brand that could be a global platform for the South Asian community. And we didn't know how to do it. But with COVID, and getting back to my 3 points of being fearless, looking at cost evasion, and really understanding micro attractions, we decided, let's go and become a live streaming content platform. Let's fearlessly break through that. Because we knew we wanted to stay connected to the other people in our community. We really looked at our numbers and decided where to shift money to, from people to technology, hired new staff that knew live streaming better than anybody else in the country, and invested in a new way to communicate with the community before anybody else did. So much of my competition watched us and reached out to us to learn how to do live streaming for their own brands. And we said, we'll help you. Here's our blueprint. You know, and we saw the traction, you know, when the number of viewers ended up increasing day by day, the organic reach ended up going higher and higher. And I think it was June where we hit 1 million organic impressions 2 months after we started. And it was an incredible moment for my entire team. And we have a long way to go as we think about what DC Fest is going to do next. But my point is, we were able to break through and find an opportunity for innovation and still stay relevant. And now potentially turn us from a single day festival into a large global brand that could truly be the voice of the community. The last 3 points that I want to share with you guys, as you get through this crisis innovation, really think about slowing down. You know, most of us, our first gut reaction was to go, 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 go. We operated out of fear. We operated out of paranoia. Rightfully so. This is all brand new. Nobody's, you know, trained us for these kind of moments. And you can't prepare emotionally when something like this happens, especially those of us that's got family that we got to take care of, both here and back home. And so forcing yourself to slow down, forcing yourself to let go of your fears, forcing yourself to let go of a version of your future that is so bad is really important. You know, as humans, we have the unique ability to think of the worst case scenarios that hasn't happened yet. And so much of our decision today ends up reflecting a future that might never happen, because we have the ability to dream of the worst things that could happen. So slow down, take a step if you haven't done so already, take a deep breath. Know that this too shall pass. And if you look at my first 6 bullet points, there's opportunities for your company to innovate. So slow down, Let go of your fears. Know that you too will get through this. Number two, invest in yourself. You know, so much of the innovation that I've experienced is by investing in myself during these tough times. The amount of content I read, the amount of motivational videos I saw, the amount of podcasts I started listening to, all 10x'd. Because when you're empty inside, when you don't have inspiration and you're working out of desperation, you need to flip that switch off and turn on a different switch. And that is inspiration and innovation and openness and daydreaming and whatever else you want to call it. To do that, you got to invest in yourself. We saw a new vision for Schoolio because we paid attention and listened to moms and dads talk about healthcare. We paid attention to innovation in healthcare and see what are people doing with technology, with services, foreign companies, local companies, and found a way for us to steal a piece of that. You know, with ACFest, we learned live streaming, hardware, software, you know, this sort of a setup would never have been possible for me. But now I have a full home studio and we've got our studio at our office, and you know, we're on course to do over 1,000 shows this year. 1,000 shows. I can't even imagine. So invest in yourself as often as possible, especially during these crisis times. Number three, invest in your people. You know, they're the ones that get up in the morning believing in your dream. And it's an important, important part of getting through these pandemics. And listen to them. You know, listen to what they're experiencing. And be open-minded and flexible enough to listen to their solutions. In times like this, everybody's opinion should count, because you never know where the next innovative idea is going to originate from. What pain point, what inspiration, what moment that can create it. And you have to create room and space for that. So invest in your people. Finally, Applause, the third company we had mentioned. One of the companies that we spent over, I think, 3 years now developing technology around tipping, booking engines, really for the live market. And our entire premise was musicians that are performing live should be able to monetize fan love through our technology. In the last 3 years, the amount of money we spent in prototyping, building our new teams, innovation, all of it got wiped out because there's no more live events. And as hard as we try, the online space, the live streaming space, the problem market fit is just not happening. There's too many players in that market. It was really crowded already, and we didn't really care about it because we were creating a piece of technology for a real life event, not a live streaming digital event. And we still haven't figured out the fit yet. You know, the last 5 months have been frustrating because this is one of the longest projects in my life, of hundreds of thousands of dollars spent, and we can't find a fit. While there's, you know, 800 people using it and making some money, we have artists in India, Canada, US, Brazil, we just opened up London. We haven't fully figured out the solution, and I'm following the same steps that I'm encouraging you to follow, yet we have no answer. And that's okay, because we're not in a rush to create a market fit when it doesn't exist. And one of the best ways to break an idea is to try to force fit it into something that it's not. And so for now, Applause is sort of sitting in the background, helping out the folks that we're helping out, and that we'll continue to pay attention. And as the world heals and humans get back together and live events and music showcases start to re-engage in some form or shape, we believe Applause can be relevant again. But for now, it's going to sit in the shadows, and that's the only thing we can do. And that's okay, you know. And that's unfortunately some of the realities that some of you might be facing. That the project that you've been working on, the company you've been building, does not have a space today in the current format. And it's really important to understand that it's not a finite truth, okay? It simply means in today's reality, which could all change in a month, or in 2 months. In today's reality, what you have no longer makes sense. But I encourage you to continue to pay attention, continue to find innovative ways to think about it, daydream, let go of logic, and look at where can you solve a new variety of the same problem that you're trying to solve. That's what we're doing. And so I hope the three backstories that I shared, I help you understand that there's a lot of opportunities to innovate in crises. And some of us are going to thrive, and some of us will take a little bit longer, but I believe all of us who are entrepreneurs are made for this specific moment. When the world needs heroes, I believe it's the entrepreneurs that are the heroes that we need, who step up, will take the risk, who will build companies, who will find solutions, and who will find ways for us as human beings to stay connected and solve each other's problems. Thank you so much for allowing me to share today. Thank you to the team at Latin for inviting me, and all of you for watching this morning. I hope you have an amazing conference with Latin. I could be reached on LinkedIn, email, IG, you know, if I could help you. I'm still coaching and mentoring a ton of startups on their path to innovation coming out of crises. And thank you again, Latin, for inviting me. Have a great conference, everyone.